Pastor Semenya is an 18-year-old South African who won a world championship yesterday, but her celebration was short-lived after officials ordered her to undergo a series of tests.
Controversies ever. Mary Decker, the golden girl of American athletics, versus arch-enemy Zola Bud, a South African who turned brutish so she could compete.
And the 18-year-old South African has run straight into a controversy.
Running barefoot in the 3,000 meters final, Bud had just taken the lead.
Castor Semenya, who is widening her advantage with every stride now.
And the crowd on tiptoe. 4:29 at the bell. Again, just a second outside.
800 meter race. Really a woman at all.
I don't think there's any question that she was in the wrong. And I do hold her responsible for what happened.
People aren't used to women being so passionate. It scares them. One day, I just said it doesn't matter what other people think. I'm a fashion model who can dunk.
I'm a girl. That doesn't mean I have to wear a skirt.
Doesn't mean I can't get all fired up.
The name of the government says it all. Apartheid. Afrikaans word meaning separateness. In the eyes of the government, those who were classified as non-white South Africans by the government's scientific tests were considered third-class citizens in their own home country. The idea of race was placed into the hands of the government and implemented as a way to keep the population segregated. This idea of race, however, was taken into the hands of the people and looked at as a socially defined term. Therefore, the people were able to come together and self-identify as a repressed regime of the apartheid South Africa. Much like the notions of race, identity brings people together across ethnic divisions, nationalities, cultures, and gender. Gender and feminism in sport is a theme seen throughout the careers of both Castor Semenya and Zola Bud, who are excellent examples of overcoming both gender and racial discrimination throughout their current and past careers. Although from different eras in South African history, both Semenya and Bud can share one major thing in common and help to continue and show the importance of women's sports. Both had to face their own individual issues during their careers. However, these women strive for greatness while shedding light on the importance of women's sports and the ideas of power and race on the international stage. The 1980s don't seem too long ago within the overall history of the world, and yet we forget that only a short 30 years ago, there was a country where walking into the wrong public bathroom could cost you your life. Apartheid South Africa was the stage for Zola Bud growing up, competing in the middle distance running events. Because of the segregated nature of her home country, she was not allowed to compete internationally due to the sports boycott. Bud's discrimination on an international stage was due to the country from which she came and how within that country the majority of the population was being treated as third-class citizens. The sports boycott was the way the world decided to send a message to South Africa that the segregated way of the country needed to come to an end. Under apartheid rule, Bud was among the race deemed superior. Under international rules, however, she was deemed as part of a backwards nation for her segregated way of life. Born May 26th in 1966 in Bloemfontein, Orange Free State, South Africa, middle distance runner Zola Bud made her name known by breaking the women's world record for the 5,000 meter race in 1984 at the young age of 17. However, her claim to fame went unrecorded due to the sports boycott. This boycott within South Africa was not only aimed at ending segregated sports within the nation, but the apartheid regime as a whole. This would be done by bringing the country into the international spotlight, where the issue of segregated country would no longer be hidden. By refusing to integrate their nationally competing sports teams, citizens of all races were affected. However, for the first time, the white South Africans were finally getting a taste of what it felt like to not be allowed to compete. By taking away sports from the entire country and not just a select group, the aim was to break the segregation throughout the sports and eventually the nation as a whole. Not being able to compete for her own nation due to the boycott, Bud managed to gain a British passport in time to compete on the British team in Los Angeles Olympic Games in 1984. Her ability to gain a British passport so quickly, along with her joining the British Olympic team, gained her much resentment from her fellow South Africans, especially those who had been trying to get a passport to leave the country and had been waiting up to a year to gain them. Her collision with favorite American runner Mary Decker during the 3,000-meter race caused Bud to finish seventh, while Decker had to be carried off the track, followed the accident. This only added to the existing resentment towards Bud. The struggles that Bud had to overcome to reach her goals were based on a current political standing of her home nation. However, if the color of her skin, the sport that she favored to play, or the time period that she lived in and competed in had been any different, we would not be reading about her today. How one was racially classified by the government was the determining factor in all aspects in one's life under apartheid South African rule. However, gender was the deciding factor in whether or not one could be taken seriously as an athlete just 30 years earlier. The participation of women at the Olympics has always been below 50%. It has risen from about that 10% until World War II to 45% in 2012. Certain sports that have been historically popular with women often are not included in the Olympics and are the only recent additions to the game. Caster Semenya, a young 21-year-old middle distance runner, same as Zola Bud, likely would not have ever had her times recorded if she lived in the 1980s due to her race. However, neither Semenya nor Bud would have been considered a real athlete if it was not for the women who fought for representation on the international scale in sports before them. Recently, there has been research into the idea that success in female sports in the Olympics brings not only success to the nations, but to male athletes as well. Greater gender equality was also associated with greater success for men. Societies that bring women into the workforce generate wealth in ways that are not captured with traditional wealth measures, such as gross domestic product. These societies may afford both men and women greater opportunities for recreational and personal pursuits, including elite athletic training and competition. The idea that gender equality within a nation in the sports community allows for the society to thrive and maintain wealth across a broad station is not something that is too hard to figure out. If you allow for a great part of the population to have equal opportunities, then the people will be happier, healthier, and overall more productive. Thankfully, both Bud and Semenya were allowed to compete against all the obstacles that they faced. However, if the gender equality in sports had not happened, neither one would be able to compete for their nations, no matter what era they raced in or the color of their skin. Fortunately enough for the international running community and Semenya herself, her running career is ongoing today. She still faces discrimination on a whole new level that Bud had never had to endure, one thing that has nothing to do with her racing at all.
So this is her enemies saying that...
Caster's enemies says that she's a boy because they're jealous.
Caster Semenya was born January 7th, 1991, in a small South African village. She is currently competing in middle distance events for South Africa and holds silver and gold medals in both the Olympics and World Championships. At an early age, Semenya began running as a way to train for soccer. However, talent like hers cannot remain unnoticed for very long. In 2008, she ran in the Junior World Championships and received gold for her 800-meter time of 2 minutes and 4 seconds. Following her wins in 2009, her drastic gain in speed across the board raised suspicion in the eyes of the International Association of Athletes Federation and the world as well. The IAAF said that they felt obligated to investigate the advance in times, such as the ones that Semenya had made, in only a short 9 months.
People look at Caster, they look at photographs of her in the newspaper like that, and they say, she's very muscly, yeah?
Yes, she does some exercise every day.
Yeah. That's why
The results seen by Semenya in the past 9 months are usually the result of performance-enhancing drugs. The IAAF proceeded to do a series of drug tests on Semenya. However, along with the drug tests she was told that she had to undergo, they also asked her to undergo gender testing. As was later found out, the drug tests that were being done were nothing more than a cover-up for the gender testing that the IAAF wanted to do on Semenya after her incredible win. Having your success being questioned due to suspicion of performance-enhancing drugs is one thing, but having it questioned because people believe you to be a man is taking sexism to a whole new level. As a woman, both Semenya and Bud's successes is a new and modern fact for the world to have to face. To many early 20th century observers, the female athlete represented the bold and energetic modern woman, breaking free from Victoria constraints and tossing aside old-fashioned ideas about separate spheres for men and women. The idea that Semenya's appearance did not neatly fit into the predetermined, socially acceptable view of what a woman should look like made people force her to validate her gender, and it's unacceptable. The IAAF has taken it upon themselves to define gender using a metric of hormone levels. They now require every female athlete to undergo hormone level exams upon entering competition, and if they want, the IAAF can deem those levels too high, and then they must undergo some type of hormone-related treatment to bring those levels down. There are a number of problems with this, some of which being gender testing of any kind is not being done on male athletes. Testosterone levels in female athletes can be raised upon high levels of physical training, and now the IAAF is banning hormone treatments in athletes and mandating it as well. Elaine Salo, a professor at the University of Pretoria, makes an intriguing point. What is athletics if not the ability of the biological body to extend itself? Both Bud and Semenya, as female athletes, have put their bodies through so much stress to perform at a higher standard every single day that it is not surprising that their bodies may have a higher producing level of testosterone than usual. Salo's question about athletes is generally really emphasized the idea that sports really can parallel the issues of the world around us. Being from two different eras in South Africa, both Bud and Semenya can come together across racial and ethnic differences over their shared gender. Semenya and Bud are indeed both high-performing female athletes and can be looked at as models for overcoming discrimination in each other's own way. In the late 1960s and early 1970s, women's sports entered a dramatic new era, a period of tremendous gains and even higher hope for women athletics. Growing up a girl, no matter where you are in the world, is an experience much different from growing up a boy. Sports can be used as a way to channel and practice liberating actions that can then be used within daily life choices and overall female empowerment throughout women's lives. Sports as an embodied practice may liberate girls and women from constraints, female ideals, and empower them within their communities, provide positive health and welfare outcomes, and ultimately transform gender notions, leading to more egalitarian world and unleashing the productivity, intellectual, and social power of women. This, then, would contribute to the overall development, economic, and social political standards. Leman Dayak, president of the IAAF, should not be the one determining whether a woman looks like a woman or not. As was later found out, the drug tests that were being done were nothing more than cover-ups for a gender testing that the IAAF wanted to do on Semenya after her incredible win. We have to take a step back and think, would this be happening to a white female athlete representing the United States or a European nation? If Zola Budd had won her infamous race against Mary Decker, would her identity as a British citizen have been questioned in the same way? Why is it that gender seems to be an easier thing to question than citizenship? Knowledge of the tests was leaked only hours after the race was over, and the reaction of people towards them was not a positive one. A number of athletes, including the retired sprinter Michael Johnson, criticized the organization for its response to the incident. How is it that the issue of gender can be so easily questioned in the case of Semenya on the modern-day stage, where the questionability of citizenship gained by Zola Budd was left completely alone? When you're growing up a girl, you're constantly reminded that you're a girl, whereas when you're growing up a boy, you've just been told that you're a regular person. Both women saw early on in their lives that they could use sports as a way to express themselves physically and to channel their abilities and lead them to success in all aspects of their lives. They are among the women that helped pave the way for the generations to come after them and create a world where female athletes is nothing out of the ordinary. From the first modern Olympic Games in 1896 held in Athens, where no woman was allowed to compete because it was thought to be impractical, uninteresting, unaesthetic, and incorrect, to today's upcoming Games held in Rio in 2016, where every single nation is sending female athletes to compete in a number of different events. The most important thing in the Olympic Games is not winning, but partaking. The essential thing in life is not conquering, but fighting as well. The idea that women were finally able to compete on an international stage is a freedom that both Bud and Semenya can relate to across all divides. The mentality of both women striving to compete no matter what obstacles are in their way, whether it be race or gender questioning, is something that only sports can allow them to come together and overlook. The Olympics are more than just a sporting event platform, but a metaphor for world cooperation, the idea of international competition that is wholesome and healthy, an interplay between countries that represents the best in all of us.